Good afternoon, everybody. So, first of all, we have Katharine Round. And Katharine's a producer and director with over 17 years of experience in creative documentary for broadcast. Her work has been on BBC and Channel 4 and ITV, and she's head of Disobedient Films and runs a part of Dockheads. Her current project is the critically acclaimed film The Divide, which is in cinemas now and was inspired by the book The Spirit Level, and it tells the story of income inequality through the eyes of seven individuals at different points in the income scale. Prior to this, she's also been involved in other recent projects, which include London Recruits, which was an experimental and interactive film and shown at the V&E recently as part of the Disobedient Objects exhibition. Katharine explores the big pictures in an intimate form, and as a teenager she was fascinated by mathematics, which she just saw as another language. So it's probably perhaps serendipity, if you like, that Katharine started looking at the film The Divide and inequality and translating that into another language of film. So Katharine, thank you very much for coming along today. On my far right we have, or I'm sure he's not, but on my far right we have writer and director Gordon Main, who comes from a drama background initially, and after a spell in documentary filmmaking, set up a production company, Pembrokeshire TV, which was instrumental in the forefront of video on demand television and on the internet, and also had some breaking stories which were then picked up by the BBC, Bloomberg and others. In 2009, he, with a partner, founded Barefoot Films, and they have produced over 45 pieces of work which have been shown internationally and within the UK on various genres. Gordon is currently directing his first feature-length documentary, which is an incredible story of young men and women who were recruited in the UK during the apartheid regime and travelled to South Africa to fight against apartheid. It's a sensational story which has actually been hidden for about the past 40 years and has only recently come to light. Thank you for being here. And then on my left we have Tony Garnett, who spent his life telling stories. Now, Tony's story himself started in Birmingham before he moved to London to study psychology. But he spent, I understand, spent most of his time acting rather than studying psychology. Describing himself as a jack of all trades and helping to make dramatic fiction for the screen, it's easy to describe Tony via his work, and it's a long list. I won't go into it all. But does include Zed Cars, The Wednesday's Play, Kathy Come Home, and amongst many collaborations with Ken Loach, includes Kez, which he was writer, co-writer and producer for the Barry Hines book, A Kestrel and a Knave, as well as other stories, Spongers, Prostitutes, and Handgun. All of these stories, while maybe older films, are unfortunately still as relevant today as they were then, and I really would encourage you to watch some of these films. Tony also had a prestigious academic career, and it's easy to define your work by your achievements, but I understand he defines his own success by smaller personal achievements. Not least, and this is one of my favourites, is the reaction of people in the establishment when they're then held to account by your work. But what Tony has made so far has provided us with numerous dramas, and in which the obvious is allowed to emerge from the hidden. That's part of a true great storytelling ability, is to take the obvious out of the hidden. So there's no doubt that we have a panel who care deeply about inequality and injustice, and I hope that we learn a lot today, not just from the successes, but perhaps some of the challenges that they have faced along the way, because that is from where we learn. Tony, thank you very much for your time today. We're very honoured to have you on the panel. If we can show the clips, thank you. But I think you'll agree that all of these films and the clips that we have shown all have a political slant. And I just now want to turn to the panel, and perhaps Tony, you first, and then Katharine and Gordon afterwards. But can you say something about the role of the producer in filmmaking? And do we have a duty to entertain? And can we really make the changes that we want in our society through film? Just a short question to start with. You two got time to think.
Easy one to start. Sorry, is this working?
Yes.
Okay, thanks. Good afternoon, everybody. It's a privilege to be here. It always is a privilege to speak at a trade union event. I've been a trade unionist all my working life. And as my friend Ken said in the previous meeting, it's our only strength, our collective strength. We live in an age of individualism, but if we want to achieve anything, and achieve anything that concerns the subject this afternoon, we can only do it in solidarity and collectively. The producer. That can mean anything you want it to be. If you watch the credits on any American renewable one-hour series, you will see up to a dozen producer credits. And I don't know what any of them do. And what's more, most of the people working on these shows don't know what any of them do. If you make a movie and you see produced by, that person could easily be the star's manager, the star's lover, the star's hairdresser. I did not make that up. It could be somebody's management, or it could be some villain who has somehow put the money together, never goes near the location, and hasn't the first idea about how to make films. But they're called the producer because if, in that Hollywood nonsense called the Oscars, that movie gets the Best Picture Award, the person who goes up to get it is called the producer. So, when you see a producer credit, you have no idea what that person did, if that person did anything at all. When I started producing, it was at the BBC, and the head of drama there reorganized the BBC and invented for the BBC the role of the producer. It didn't exist before that. Directors chose what they wanted to do, and the head of the department gave them a nod, and they went off and did it. That's how the BBC worked. It was expanding, and Sidney Newman, the new boss who came from Canada, installed this new system. The producer at the BBC decided what was going to be made. I mean, I'm from the Brian Clough School of Filmmaking. Brian Clough, you remember, said football is a simple game, why make it complicated? And filmmaking is answering three questions. The what question, the who question, and the how question. And the producer at the BBC decided the what question. What are we going to make? What is it going to say? Who's going to write it? And then works with the writer. And then the producer decided who was going to direct it. And with the director, decided who was going to be the DOP, who was going to be the editor, who was going to be in it. So it dawned on me that if I was allowed to answer the what question and was instrumental in answering the important who question, the how question had more or less taken care of itself, which is why I became a producer. I might have stayed acting, I might have become a screenwriter, but a screenwriter, as we know, is the lowest form of animal life. Nobody cares about the screenwriter. Everybody depends on the screenwriter, but nobody cares about them, particularly in Hollywood and in the film business. Ken is a great exception. He always acknowledges his screenwriter, but how many directors do? How many producers do? I could have been a director, but I would have had to wait to be invited. And as an actor, I'd spent too many years waiting to be invited. Writing is the only thing you can do without having the invitation to do it. And I didn't want that kind of life. So I became a producer. And my idea as a producer was that I would decide what we were going to do. And I would develop the screenplay if I wasn't going to write it. And then, having been given this power from the BBC, which you really were given some power then. I don't want to exaggerate it. There were limits, strict limits, and there were some terrible battles. And I've got the scars to prove them. But there was some room to manoeuvre, which you don't have now. Because they believed in producer power to some extent. And in the BBC then, the rule was, if you had a problem, refer upwards. Well, I never thought I had much of a problem, and I thought the management were quite busy, so we just got on with it. And that was allowed to some extent. But having been given that power, and this is the important point for a producer, you must then devolve it. You must offer the power that you have to the director, to everyone else, to the writer. So that it becomes a genuine collective achievement. That, to me, what producing is. Producing is not just organizing like a good production manager does. Of course it has to be organized. A producer should care about what was going to be made and love good work out of people. That's all I've ever done. You saw that clip. God, that was 50 years ago, that film. Just reminds me how old I am. That film was achieved by Jeremy Sanford and Ken Loach and Tony Immey, who was on the camera, and Roy Watts in the editing room, and of course Carol and Ray and many other people. I didn't make it, I just made it happen. But a producer can't do that unless the producer's given some room to do it. And perhaps we'll discuss that a bit later.
Yes, thank you. Catherine?
Thank you.
Thank you, Julie.
Just to try and see if I can add anything to this conversation. I didn't want to be a producer of The Divide. I didn't intend to be a producer on The Divide or even the producer of The Divide. But I think the industry has changed a lot, and certainly this film would not have been, I don't believe, could have been made within the current mainstream broadcasting system, which is quite sad, I think. And so therefore, because I was convinced that this was a film that should be made, that it became part of my role to ensure that it was made, which involved coming up with a way to raise the money, and being involved in all that side of things, which I'd never intended to do. And I never, I'm not a film producer. I am now, but I certainly didn't see myself as one then. I was a director that had worked partly in broadcast television and partly independently on other independently funded projects. But the scale of this was immense, and in some ways it needed to be immense. It needed to be a project which rightfully was highlighting the voices of some people who are not often heard, and you know, it wasn't the way that British Television would have made it. They would have made a film at the spirit level, and they would have made a panorama with the graphs, which is a very valid way to make it, but I wanted in a way to put those voices in the foreground. So It was a battle making it. I will be honest. You know, we had to raise finance completely independently through a crowdfunding campaign, which, you know, at the time was, I think, one of the most successful UK crowdfunding campaigns. in this country on Indiegogo. If you define it really narrowly, it makes it sound really impressive. and you know, it gave me the confidence that there were that the audience was there that wanted this film, that this film was important, because you know, for a while I'd been developing it and thinking this is a very important story. But then you suddenly think, well, what if nobody cares? And I think it was, you know, seeing that, you know, it was a collective financing process. It was people contributing what they could to make this film happen. And having that vote of confidence in a way kind of inspired me to continue on the long journey, which was making this film. But to reference directly the question as to whether it is the producer's job to
entertain, and can we make change through our films?
Well, I think absolutely you can make change through films. I mean, I hope so. I think the way that we see the world is completely shaped by, entirely shaped by, but how we reflect the world through the films that we make shapes how the world is seen. And I think it's an incredible responsibility. It's an incredible honour as a filmmaker that you have that much power, but it's an incredible responsibility, and I do believe that it is our responsibility to make films that tell these important stories and that allow the voices of people who aren't often heard to be heard.
Thank you. Gordon, have you anything to?
Hello. So I'm losing my voice. I mean, I think I'm glad you reminded me what the question was, because I'd sort of forgotten that. But I mean, I must say, you know, I think Katharine and I were talking before, and you know, feel very honoured and awed to be on the same panel as someone like Tony, who, you know, in Kathy Come Home, I mean, I didn't see it when it first came out, but it did. I was alive. I was a baby, I think. And I remember seeing it on repeat, and it was one of the most amazing experiences of watching a film. It was just mind-blowing, you know, sort of sometime in the 70s, I guess. But it was one of those things where it utterly gripped you and kept you and left you at the end thinking, this is wrong and something's got to happen to change that. You know, what that story needs action and somebody needs to do something about it. And, you know, I think I was 12 or 14, I don't think I felt that I could, but it did change things, you know. British government policy of housing was changed as a result of that film. But going back to the question, I think there is no doubt at all that that film was entertaining. It was gripping. It was great storytelling. It grabbed you and it didn't let you go to the end. It involved you emotionally. And I guess if that's a definition of entertainment, you know. And I think entertainment has become corrupted now. I mean, there are entertainment commissioners in the building, I think. And entertainment now means song and dance routines and sort of you know, all sorts of other things. And I think, you know, one of the things I wanted to mention. Thanks, Tom. Thank you very much. He's a very lovely man. You know, he actually risked very serious torture and imprisonment in South Africa, and it's a real privilege of mine to be able to make a film about some of the actions that he and his comrades did. But I think recapturing. The idea that entertainment doesn't have to simply mean switching off or being sort of properly entertained on a very sort of narrow way. Because when I was sort of thinking about this panel, I was thinking that actually, you know, all filmmaking, you know, almost all activity is political. And the fact that that films like Katharine's and Tony's and other, you know, there are some very great political documentaries out there. The fact that we all go, oh, that's an amazing film, it's so brilliant, is because they are, you know, often beacons of light, and the background against which they're set is actually a call to action, but it's a call to go to sleep, to buy the latest product, to think that voting is texting in to choose who should win the Bake Off or the whatever it is. So, you know, we are overwhelmed by films which have a political impact, and they largely suppress us. Divide us, make us think of ourselves as separate units. And I think the great thing that film can do is actually remind us that no, we're not, we're in it together, you know. And one of the main reasons I was attracted to the London Recruit story is not only is it an incredible, incredible story of very brave young people. I mean, I'm just looking around the room, but I think they were younger than anybody in here. You know, they were, correct me if I'm wrong, but you know, they were 20, 21, 22. And they literally, some of them never been on a plane before. They were recruited by a very charismatic man and said, look, you know, you're going to these rallies, you're standing up at meetings and making speeches, you're identifying yourself as in solidarity. Do you want to really do something? Get on a plane and go undercover in apartheid South Africa, where if you're caught, you will be tortured, you will be in prison for a very long period of time. But that's standing up and doing something. And I think my feeling is that that example is the kind of thing that we do need today. People need to do things. I don't mean necessarily go undercover in totalitarian regimes, you know, with a sudden rush into North Korea to try and do something. Because actually, the new totalitarianism is not that new. It's been written about several times, but the BBC Radio 4 is just broadcasting Brave New World at the moment. And if you listen to that first episode, they could be describing Trump. They could be describing the technological changes that have happened in the last 5 years. It is absolutely terrifyingly prescient, more so now than it was when I looked at it at O level. It's incredible how accurately Aldous Huxley foresaw what was coming. And I think the new political activism is to say, no, I'm not going to watch this mind-numbing nonsense. I'm going to seek out great films because they're there. You know, these internet platforms mean they're there. And you can join them, and they've all got communities attached to them, because like Katharine, you know, to get a film off the ground now, to be a producer, in effect, you have to hustle and get money, which means you have to have a website, which means you have to have a Facebook page, you know, and you have to sort of get out there and do incredible things and endlessly try and sell, you know, the involvement and tell people about the story. And so what you find is actually all of these projects have communities around them, and we are able to get involved and join in and be part of it. And so then I'll stop talking, because Morag's looking at me with that stop talking.
Morag had a raised mic, please. No, thank you. I just actually wanted to pick up on a point that you made, and a point that Tony made, actually, in relation to, if we accept that the definition of entertainment has shifted quite dramatically, and if we also accept that the decisions that the producers are making have also shifted, is it that this type of film has fallen out of fashion with audiences, or are we being censored? And also, from your collective experience, how do filmmakers, particularly filmmakers in this room, break through in order to get good entertaining, in the proper definition, work seen? Any of you can.
I think we've got to take it away from whether an individual can do this or do that, and individuals now feeling that are failure because they can't do certain things. It's not about that. It's about living with the prevailing ideology, and the times have changed. It's not just the technology has changed. The technology change actually is welcome. It's causing some professional difficulties, but it's absolutely wonderful. And maybe we'll come to that and how we can use it. But this question of political freedom is not a question of people not wanting to. It's a question of a world now where that is not allowed. Because the political climate is different. If you live in a world of market fundamentalism, then if you want to make left-wing films, they're not going to let you. And every film is political. The point was made over there. Do you think Downton Abbey is not a political drama? It's intensely political. Written by an intensely political writer. And all those films and TV shows that say they're not political, they are the most political. Because they are unconsciously political, and they're the ones that really get you. So, if you want to make socialist drama, for instance, which is what I've always wanted to do and tried to do, it's going to be much more difficult now because the climate is different. So you've got to be cannier, and your tactics have got to be different. And I'm happy if you wish to come to that at some point.
Or now, if you wish.
Okay. don't try in Hollywood. I've got even more scars to show you. in what is known as the European art film, there is still some room. Partly because all over Europe, public money is still contributed. But to get any creative freedom in the European art film, you probably need a named director. Usually a director with a style, with a signature. This means that for about $5 million or something like that, across Europe with all the subsidies, a distributor will take the chance. Because if you show that film with the named director big on the publicity, an audience will say, oh, we know that director, so we know what we're going to see. It's sort of pre-sold. This is true brilliantly with Ken now. It's true of Mike Lee. It's not true of Stephen Frears, because Stephen does a whole range of films with a different signature on each one. So if you have a director like that, you can really push the content. You've got to find a director like that, and you've got to find a director like that who is ideologically as sympathetic as you are if you're a producer. If you're a director, you've got to get to that position, which is very difficult. And it probably will take you until you're middle-aged to be able to do that. And you might even have to do the odd commercial movie in order to do it. The other way to do it, of course, is to attract a star, which is something I've always hated, but it's one way to do it. And sometimes a big star, in order to get to be taken seriously again, having made a mint of money in some Hollywood crap, will want to do a serious art house movie. It just sort of raises their profile. And some actors are politically interested in that. So you've got to be canny. And you've got to, and the same in television. What you've got to do now, even more than I had to do, is in order to get the money, in order to get it made, you've got to raise the money, and then you've got to be on a platform. You've got to get it released by a distributor, or you've got to get it shown prime time. So there's always an executive to satisfy. Or as Ken was saying earlier on, a whole lot of them, all mini-managing you. Our industry now suffers from managementitis, which is a nasty disease that has gone all through the educational establishment, all through the NHS, all through the BBC, and it is an extremely difficult thing to deal with. What I decided to do in the years I was working after managementitis started, and what you're going to have to do, if you don't do it already, is, particularly in television, you've got to make what I labelled Trojan horse drama. You've got to find out what they want. What will they buy? And then you've got to say, I'll give you that. They may want a genre series or a genre piece, because the one they love the best is a cop show. They love cop shows, because they think the audience loves cop shows. So you say, well, I'll give you a cop show. Really? Oh, good. And then you hide your show inside the cop show. So you deliver them their show. And they'll show your show. In fact, one example was a series actually called The Cops, which we did for the BBC. Maybe I should be concrete about this and give an actual example. What I wanted to do was produce a series about a sink estate somewhere in the north of England, which had been going downhill since Thatcher. Industries had died, men had left to try and find work elsewhere, drifted away. There were a lot of single parent families. There was no work. The only growth industry was drugs. That was the only career enhancement you could get. Run down, poverty stricken, depressed. And there are dozens and dozens and dozens of them. Still are. I wanted to show the other side of Blair's paradise. Now, the way to do that, of course, is that you need some key characters who each week will go, as it were, from house to house, from problem to problem, so that you can reveal people's lives and make the political series you want to make. But I knew that if I'd gone to Mark Thompson, who was controller of BBC Two at the time, and said, oh, yes, Mark, this was just when I'd said I wouldn't do any more of this life, and they were in a huff about that, but it was boring me, so I stopped it. If I'd said to him, I want to do a series about some social workers, Mark, he'd have said, get out of here. Or being Mark, he would have said, very interesting. I just wonder whether there is an audience for it. But in other words, it would be no. So I said, I want to do a cop show, please. He said, oh, you want to do a cop show? Oh, very excellent, good, do a cop show. So we did a cop show about uniformed cops in Bolton. And every episode, what they did was go to this estate where there was always trouble. And they went from house to house, from case to case, where we could reveal the life that was people were being forced to live. So inside the cop show was my show. So be tactical. Secondly, when you're selling a show, a political show, don't be strident, don't be militant. Sell it. Make it sound attractive. Minimize the ideology of it. And talk about the characters, talk about the conflict. Give them a reason to buy it. And don't make them the enemy, even if you hate the buggers. Get them on your side. This is true of senior executives, it's true of commissioners, story editors, all the various people. Get them batting for you. Getting them to see where the drama is. See where the conflict is. Talk about it in terms of individuals. Get the commission. Your fight is to get the politics onto the screen. And the way to do that is to seduce the commissioners. So pretend not to be political is the most political thing you can do. We'll come back to that. But all I'm saying is, if I may, just two other things. One is, it is possible. The clips from these two films, which make you want to see those films, they're proving that it's possible. So don't despair. Don't despair. The other thing is, don't run away with the idea about political films changing the world. They don't. When I was young and arrogant, I thought we could make a film and change the world. Well, we couldn't. That clip that you just saw, there was a very small problem with homelessness in 1966. It was real, but small. We made the film, and the result of that film was two. One was there was slight improvement in part for accommodation. That's about it. But Ken Loach and I have got a very nice place to live in. Thank you. It really helped our careers. That was the political effect of Cathy Come Home. What you can do with a film is raise consciousness. You can actually involve people emotionally as well as intellectually in the predicament of others. And that is clearing the ground for political work that can change the world. So let's not be under misunderstanding about films. Now, there are far more homeless. The housing scandal is an absolute disgrace. There are people sleeping on the streets. I don't have to go tell you all about it. You all know. When we made Cathy, nobody knew. Ken and I didn't know until Jeremy had researched it. Now, everybody here knows. There's documentaries twice a week on television. There's headlines in the newspapers. And nobody gives a fuck. In the end. For years and years and years we've known, and nothing ever is done. And you make a film about it now, nothing will be done. But you make a film about it, or other problems like Kenny's just done, and people might be so moved and so inspired, they will want to get together to do something about it. And that is an honourable thing to try to do.
Actually, the making the divide as well is a similar process, and that I never set out with the film does not have an over agenda in that way. It's telling individual stories in the way to, in the aim to create a connection and make people understand this abstract concept of inequality. It's putting a face on it, and the idea that this one film would somehow change the world has always seemed to be quite a ludicrous one, although people have often put it to me, and of course, as a filmmaker, you always would, arrogantly would like your film to make some change, but you know that in some way you're just part of a bigger process through which people's minds are changed, through which we foreground these stories, through which we might move people and create the political will for some of these policies and political change that we know that we want to see. And that's where I suppose I feel very passionate in being part of that process, and I think it's a worthwhile process to do. I think communicating these messages and making people and creating that emotional engagement is a really, really important and powerful part of the whole process of political change. And as Tony said, everything that we do is political one way or the other. It all contributes to how we view the world. It all contributes to the prevailing ideology. And of course, the sad fact that so much of our broadcasting is pushed down a much more sort of marketized route does present quite a few challenges for a filmmaker. But in a slightly more optimistic note, technological change has actually opened up, although it's caused numerous problems, it has also opened up whole new ways of getting films made. And certainly I don't think that the divide could have been made before the age of the internet and before the age of new ways of bringing people together, new distribution platforms. I mean, it is being shown in cinemas, but ultimately it's being shown in cinemas because that's how you get newspapers to write about it. Ultimately we will, there will be more methods of distribution which can bypass those traditional gatekeepers. And hopefully, enable the film to be seen more widely. So I do have some optimism that, obviously, you want your film to be seen. There are ways to get the film seen. There are ways to kind of position your film so that it can be seen by people in a wider audience. But it's all part of the same process by which we keep telling these stories and keep helping to influence how the world is seen and who's listened to.
Well, certainly where we've got to with London Recruits at the moment, we couldn't possibly have done without the internet, without that ability to appeal to an audience without gatekeepers. Because, the traditional way is you've got to have an idea around a film, you go and see the commissioners, and it can just stop there. That can be it. No one else can ever find out about it if they say no. And like Katharine, you feel that it's not the kind of film that they would make in the kind of way that you would want it to be made. And so the internet means that, you know, and Katharine did a very successful crowdfunding thing. We did a crowdfunding thing. And, you know, the fact is everyone suddenly commissioning, you go, look, this is what we really want to do. Can you help us a bit? And then people can give very little bits of money, but if enough people do it and you get it out there, you know, suddenly you can go on to the next stage, and without the internet, we certainly couldn't have got to where we are now. So I think that definitely makes a big difference. I think in terms of technology of the kits, I mean, I love that the new technology, so-called, means that we can go back to using lenses and, you know, decent, get all that lovely look that used to be standard with film cameras. I love that. I am actually, contrary to a lot of the stuff that was being said on the Bechtel point of view. I mean, I worked as an editor and then as a camera person, so I self-shoot my stuff because I actually really love film and I hope I know how to use a camera. But anyway, I hope I'm not taking anybody else's job by doing that, but I do, you know, I think one of the, for somebody like me, it's a great liberation to be able to craft it visually as well as, think about the content that you want. And of course, sometimes I do use people because you can't physically, you know, in certain situations you can't physically do it yourself, and I know there are people who are better at that than me. That's you, wasn't it, Mr. Anyway, I think some of the wonders of technology are, you know, it's not as heavy as it was. I mean, I can remember, you know, 20 years ago, 25 years ago, you know, cameramen needed assistance just because you couldn't physically carry all that kit around and you're lugging those stuff. I think one of the great disasters of that is that, you know, whereas I was an assistant to all sorts of amazing people and learnt incredible stuff, through carrying the kit and making cups of tea, you know, those roles are just disappearing. So, you know, there used to be assistant editors who would, you know, lose tiny bits of celluloid and tins and things, because I know I did it, you know, and have to make lots of cups of tea. But for me, I mean, that I had this incredible experience where I worked in one of Paul Greengrass's cutting rooms on two films, and just, you know, was there till late at night next to Paul Greengrass discussing how he wanted to make a film. And, you know, it was just incredible education. And I think, you know, that downside of technology is absolutely massive. And I hope that as we make London Recruits, we can, you know, involve ourselves with some of the educational institutions or with others. Because I think, not saying that I'm Paul Greengrass, but, you know, I think that ability to be exposed to that kind of process of filmmaking for younger people, people who are keen to move up in the industry, is really, really important. Because, you know, we had it and it was great, and I think that it's a tragedy if it's lost altogether just because somebody can edit the whole film on their laptop and shoot the whole thing on their Sony FS7.
I am on Facebook and Twitter, God help me. trying to join the 21st century at my age. I'm doing it mainly because my publisher pushed me to do it. You get to be 18, you write memoirs, which I've just done, and it's going to be published in about a month. And they said I should write blogs. I didn't even know what a blog was. and to draw people to it so they'd know I'd written a bloody book. So that's what I'm doing. But actually, I'm quite enjoying writing the blogs now. My brief response to this, because I know I've got to be brief, very brief now, to this technology thing is, A, don't fight it. B, make sure you fight with the union in terms of wages and conditions, that you've got to go with it, you can't fight against it. And C, frankly, if I look at the state of the industry now, and the stranglehold that the right has over our culture, if I were in my early 20s now, starting out, I would work entirely on the internet. I might have to earn a living elsewhere to some extent. But now, the democratization of our business through technology has opened up enormous possibilities. When any kid in Bolton can nick a little camera point and shoot. You can edit on a laptop and put it up on server space, which is cheap, for billions of people to watch. That is a huge opportunity. Of course, nobody will know you're there, but that's a marketing problem. And oddly enough, kids in particular, they have ways of finding things. Even the big companies are now getting into it. And for a while, before they really close it down, there is some freedom on the internet to say things without hardly any censorship. And I would be making political statements, political dramas, very cheap, no Cossacks coming over the hill, you know, no David Lean waiting for 3 weeks to get the right lighting. Get out there and shoot, which is what we did at the BBC in the middle 60s. You know, the new technology then was 16mm blimped Arriflex, you know, which would only be used in news. And we persuaded the film department at the BBC, who were horrified, we wanted to do drama with it. And they said, oh no, 35mm for drama. And we said, no, we want it with very little light, camera on the shoulder, and get out on location. And in the end, they let us. That was the biggest professional fight of my life. Now, the opportunity is to get out there with cheap equipment and do with complete freedom on the internet. Say what you want to say. That's a real opportunity. And link that in with your ambitions in the industry. They're not exclusive. Do them. They can't stop you yet. Good luck.
Have we any?
I just want to add one tiny thing to that, if you don't mind.
Yeah.
I agree with Tony, absolutely. But I think the problem is that you do have to earn a living. And coming back to that Becky thing, if you're trying to pay a London rent and or raise children, you know what you just said is actually not possible. I don't think. I mean, that's the problem. It does seem like a democracy, but it isn't really a democracy if you can't compete. You know, if you can't actually do it because you've got other obligations, financial obligations, and heaven knows, just trying to live in this city is a crushing obligation itself. And well, students starting with huge amounts of debt made that increasingly difficult too. So I agree with
go
you.
Go and work, stay working in television to do it at the bloody weekend, or do it when you're not actually when you haven't got a job to do. But all I'm saying is that technology means you can work, you can make films. Don't hang around. Too many people are hanging around complaining that they can't get a gig, or if they get a gig, they're having to make crap. Well, if you have to make crap with the gigs you get in order to finance making really political work that you put on the internet, that's a bargain you're going to have to make. You have time to do it. And if you do it, it's going to actually help you grow politically and grow creatively. I agree that there are problems.
I have to go to the question, sorry. The marketing thing that Tony refers to is what you two did. And I crowdfunded, I'm one of the crowdfunders, I bet there are loads in this room now, who crowdfunded The Divide and the London Recruits. And that's how we make it happen, actually, is by sharing and by reaching out to other people who understand the stuff that we know is important and getting it out there. So there are ways, and we can use the internet to do that. The internet's fabulously powerful if you let it.
Thank you. Any other questions? Yes, sir. Microphone's on its way.
Hello. I'm kind of one of those kids from a bad town that was making a film or throwing back, not from Bolton, from Crewe. And I was just wondering about the people who crowdfunded it. Where did you actually put your crowdfunding? Was it just a circle of friends that you already had that got it so widely shared? Because we were considering doing a Kickstarter, but we kind of don't really have a network. We don't know where to put it other than like on Reddit and places like that. So, I mean, you know, how do you
One-hour-long seminars, if anyone's interested in the art of crowdfunding. Well, thank you. First of all, I want to say thank you to this lady for contributing to the divide, and for anyone else in this room that helped, because it really was that contributed, because it really was the thing that made this film get off the ground. But I think some that there are slight kind of misconceptions around crowdfunding, that essentially you have an idea, you put it up on one of the sites, Kickstarter or Indiegogo, and suddenly you have all these people who get excited about your idea and you raise billions of pounds and blah, blah, blah. And, you know, very occasionally that happens, very, very occasionally. Generally, you're famous to begin with. But, I mean, the fact of the matter was I did at least 2 months solid prep work before I launched The Divide, which was then called the Spirit Level Documentaries campaign. And it was by doing a crap job that I enabled myself to fund myself through that time. And essentially, it's like planning a marketing campaign. That's the only way. I mean, I've never worked in marketing, but, you know, given what I know about it, this is essentially what you're doing. You're finding all the people that you think might support your film. You're getting in touch with them. You're building those relationships. I mean, I had the Spirit Level book, which was an enormous asset. It had an existing fan base. It had, you know, 100,000 readers. I was in touch with the authors. They were on board with the project. Their organisation, the Equality Trust, was also obviously very keen to have the film made, and lots of other organisations and campaigning and political groups who are interested in the subject of inequality. They didn't know me. I had to obviously convince them that, you know, I was going to do a decent job of this and that I cared passionately about the subject. So it was a case of meeting people not on the internet in order to facilitate that when we did go live on the internet, the campaign would have sufficient traction that it would reach the people who cared about it. And even if they couldn't contribute, because, you know, often, you know, people don't have the resources to contribute, and but they can reach other people, and ultimately you're reaching as many people as possible so that those that can enable you to make the project happen can do so. And that was, I was so, skeptical about crowdfunding. I thought it was the biggest con. I was like, surely it's just a way of humiliating yourself in front of your friends and convincing your mum to give you some money. So when it actually worked, and, you know, we raised, I think it was $10,000 on the first day alone, I was in tears. I just couldn't believe that it was possible. So for me, I was a total convert at that time, that actually what we have in our hands is an incredibly powerful tool. Yes, it is causing a huge amount, it is causing problems, it is creating a lot of insecurity, it is devaluing certain elements of the industry and certain roles, but what we do have is a way to reach our audience directly, which we didn't have before. And certainly when you're making films of this nature, it can be an incredibly powerful tool. And I think that, you know, it is part of, it's not the solution, but it is certainly something that we can use.
I just echo that, and, you know, I mean, I think, you know, one of the things you do is find somebody who's done it before and pick their brains, you know, and I was very lucky, he's keeping quiet in the corner there, but James Barrett, who is the lead producer on the London Cruises, actually was brilliant at that. And but, you know, you do need, you know, we were lucky again, we had a story that had a big constituency already, but, you know, we're happy to have a chat afterwards.
Yes, ma'am. Right, yeah, my name's Sharon King. I just wanted to say that with regards to Katharine and Gordon, it's actually quite amazing to see that you're doing something that is that sort of putting stuff out there, because I have to say that what you said, Tony, is true, is that I do sort of do worry, I'm a bit scared of the fact that can you do that now? Can you still be political and still put something out there in the same way? So firstly, I'd like to say that it's brilliant to see that you two have got these films out there. But also to you, Tony, because I know that you've had world productions and that you've done various things. I just wanted to check, do you feel that you've handed the mantle along for other people to come along and be political and to continue that going forward? It's interesting that we've obviously got two younger people here who are doing that, but overall, is there anything that you're doing now to move that forward, or would you, you know, how would you see that, because it's not just from this session as well, but also the last session, I'm completely inspired. And I always was anyway by some of the people on the panel, but it's interesting, I just wonder, and I've actually asked if I could actually be mentored by Rebecca, you'll know who I'm talking about when I say that, but do you feel you're moving things forward in terms of handing the mantle on in some way?
Well, I never had a mantle. I was just, well, I walked away from the screen about a decade ago or so, because after I'd spent 50 years thinking about nothing else but how to make a screenplay work on the screen, and the novelty had worn off. I needed some time and room in my head to write. So I spent that year getting three novels out, and now this memoir out, and that's taken up my time, really. World Productions that I started, I put a lot of time in there training young people. People have done very, very little. And the people running it now are the kids I trained. And their recent drama, Line of Duty, we found the writer of that, Jed Mercurio, because we put an ad in the medical press, because we wanted to do a medical series like no other medical series, so we advertised for a doctor who can write. Why not? And we got 100 replies and picked Jed. And Jed, at that time, was a junior hospital doctor in Birmingham, and he wrote Cardiac Arrest. And since then, he's gone on and doing other things. So what I do now is occasionally I do pro bono work on political projects from the young filmmakers have got, just to give advice. I'm doing one with Franny Armstrong now. I can't do much else, really, because I'm a writer now. It's yours now. People are your age, you know? I want to get out of the way, and you go and do it. It can be done, even though the climate is much more difficult now. If you guys give up, we're finished. And I've got a feeling that in the political climates, the ideological climate, the toing and the throwing of it, that we're at a turning point. Partly because of this terrible capitalist depression, but we're moving, things are moving. And we can go nastily to the fascist right, like much of Europe and Trump and so on, or we can fight for a democratic socialist left. And as filmmakers, that is our duty, if that is our politics. And whatever the difficulties, you guys have got to get together and do it for the good, not only of your own careers, but for society. So, do it. Good luck.
Thank you. I've been informed that we have less than 3 minutes, so can we have a very quick question and some succinct answers, please, and then we'll sum up. Sorry, and then we'll sum up. Thank you.
I've just got a good quick question regarding blacklisting, because it's about blacklisting, because it's hard enough getting work, but then you get known on the internet and the web what type of programming you do, and then you don't get offered the work.
Well, I mean, I don't, you're talking about some sort of informal blacklisting, presumably, or,
yeah.
You know, I mean, I think that's absolutely right. You know, I mean, I think if you really do want to make the stuff, I mean, you know, Toby talks about, you know, his way of doing it, which I think sounds brilliant. You know, and he had a very successful early career to build on to do that. But I think there is that, you know, that Chomsky idea that, you know, the people in these positions have only got there because they would never actually commission people like you to make the kind of films that you want to make, so that's why they're not out there. So I think that does go on, and you know we've all feel that we've suffered from it. I mean, it might be that our ideas just aren't as good as other people's, of course, you know, which is the always thing you have to think when commissioners say no. And I think you just got to keep on going and keep on going and keep on going. If you want to be a filmmaker, it isn't an easy path by any means. But if you really want to do it, then you've just got to bust through all of that, because you're not going to be able to change that. I mean, commissioners change a lot now, and they go to things like this. I mean, there's three commissioners upstairs right now who are all very approachable, and you can go speak to them. So you can build up relationships with commissioners quite quickly. and they change very, very, very rapid turnover. So if you felt that somebody didn't like you, just try to build up relationships with the young, new ones, the new executive producers moving into the commissioning departments, and just try and build up a relationship so you've got a dialogue going. Often, they are so drenched and are flooded with ideas and overwhelmed by them, they might not even have read the thing that you think is being blacklisted. And they're under a lot of pressure from their bosses to go to a handful of companies who deliver and deliver and deliver massive amounts of series. So, you know, just keep going, I think, is the only thing you can do.
Great, thank you. And one of the men that told me I had no time left wants to see something, Tom.
Yeah, that's really got me. Yeah. There's a book out called Blacklisted. A couple of weeks ago, about 360 cases were settled in the High Court.
Yeah.
Of workers in the building industry who were hideously blacklisted in the 70s, the 80s and the 90s, and their lives were blighted by it. Oddly enough, I wouldn't be here now if I hadn't been blacklisted out of building trade myself then, as a spark, as I was then, right? And I ended up in television as a spark, so paradoxically it did me good in the long run. But I know I was blacklisted, I know that the employers had information on me they could have only got from the special branch, nowhere else, right? But we fought back. We didn't just say, oh, well, that's a bit of shame, we better go away and do something different. We fought, and the cases have ended up in court. Hundreds of thousands of pounds of compensation has been paid out by those bastards who blacklisted us way back in the day. So don't be intimidated by it. We can defeat the blacklist.
Just very, very briefly, just to add to that, in the middle 1960s, Jim Allen's first screenplay was called The Lump. Which was set on a building site about a man who had been blacklisted from every building site in the north because of his politics. Blacklisted by this conspiracy of building employers that you talked about. And we exposed it on television that night, but it's taken all these years for anything to be done, which goes to my point. You can raise consciousness, but a film won't actually cause a revolution. You've got to bloody do it.
Can I quickly just add? About 6 months ago, I pitched an idea to BBC Two, and it's kind of like based around Ken Loach's style of work. And they said, Ken Loach is unfashionable, keep away from that kind of work.
Every critic at Cannes didn't like Ken's film, and he came out with the Palme d'Or. So I think, on a personal level, always keep your vision. We've got three panelists here who have had a very defined vision throughout their life. They've shown some of that today. I think we've also discussed the opportunities that new technology and the internet are taking. The official definition of doing work in one area and funding it from another is called a portfolio career. I think it's becoming commonplace in our industry. But at the end of the day, if you really have a story and a passion, people on this panel and many people in this building today are showing that that can be done. You just have to drive it through. I also just wanted to thank the panel very much. I'm sure that you'll hear much more of Gordon as the film comes out and it's developed. Please do connect with the London Recruits on the internet. The Divide is screening in every picture house in across the country on Tuesday, and there are a number of Q&As and they're all listed on the website. Tony's book is actually out on the 30th of June and you can pre-order it from all good bookshops and some on the internet. But I think that there are a lot of challenges that you faced in your life described within the book. And I'm certainly looking forward to all three. Thank you for your time and attention. And Chester, one more thing. What are you? Yes.
Thank you. My name is Chester Young, producer and director. I've just made a film called Kathleen of the Voices, which is going to be premiered at the East End Film Festival on July the 2nd. I went to BBC, Channel 4, Al Jazeera, all broadcasting stations, to help me fund a film to follow the protest movement when the students rise against the rising tuition fee and how the police brutally abuse them and then criminalize them. No broadcaster wants to fund it. I funded it myself. I've got it broadcast in 2 TV stations around the world. No broadcaster in the UK wanted to touch it, and I'm premiering it soon. So yeah. Keep the faith.
Thank you. Chester says he's at the film festival. He's also, along with Jerome, worked incredibly hard in filming today. All the sessions are going to be online at some point soon. So thank you very much. I'm not going to hold you back from your drink any longer because I will get into terrible trouble. I always do for my timekeeping at the committee meetings. But thank you very much indeed for your time and attention, panel.